the Himalayas are special not only to the people living there, but to people all over the globe. Because, you know, the Himalayas sustain our weather systems, they sustain life on this planet, and I think they also inspire us. The beauty of the Himalayas is something which, you know, is priceless. Nobody can, you know, like, put a value to it.
Mountain women, in their role as managers of their local environment, hold valuable lessons for dealing with environmental changes. But they often have less access and control over the natural resources. Women leaders have come a long way in promoting this knowledge and in empowering women to lead the path to a more sustainable and equitable world.
Those areas, as you're saying, they're very fragile, they're very denuded. They're also very prone to a lot of natural disasters. I mean, if we look at northern Pakistan in 2005, we had the devastating earthquake which killed 72,000 people. The whole landscape of some of the villages changed. You know, entire mountains came down, lakes got formed, rivers got blocked, streams disappeared. Now, these are things that affect everybody, but of course they also affect women, and in some ways they affect them more. So, you know, where women were going to fetch water and those water sources disappeared, these things became a big problem.
لذا در کوهستانات شرایط زندگی بر زنها مشکل است. طور مثال در وجه بردن برق بسیار مشکل است، بردن آب بسیار مشکل است. زنها که در کوهستانات زندگی میکنند از برق، از آب، از امکانات صحی، از حتی از مکاتب محروم هستند. و همچنان بعضی مناطقی داریم مانند بامیان، بدخشان که اکثرا از برف پوشیده است که راه‌ها را بند می‌سازند. مثلا شش ماه ما با بسیار مشکل هم و مواد مورد ضرورت اولیه را توسط تیارات انتقال میتن و مردم عبور مرور مردم قطع میشه چون سرک‌های بسیار مناسب وجود نداره.
There are many challenges from the perspective of climate change for women. They have to spend more time to bring the firewood, to bring the water, and also there is the feminization of agriculture part is also there, because most of the male members are leaving the country for foreign employment, leaving their family behind in the home. And naturally, it was all the responsibilities of the women. If they have to spend more time for bringing water or to fetch firewood or for fodders, they have to spend the productive time in these unproductive works. Instead of going to school, instead of going to some income generating, engaging themselves some in income generating activities, or instead of going to some training programs, they have to spend their most productive time in these things.
I see them as being the forerunners of conservation in this country, because they are the ones who use the natural resources on a day-to-day basis. They know what sort of, whether it's abundant in this area, whether the rains, you know, if the rains are there in this month, we would get these sort of different crops to be harvested from the fields or from the forest. And they are the ones who can tell us the symptoms of what's doing well, what's not doing well. And so for me, when that realization hit us, that if we paid attention to the knowledge that is inherent in all the women in these villages, we could learn a lot about conservation and the natural cycle of things. We don't need to get alarmed if suddenly something seems a little out of sync. It's only when we tend to be very arrogant in our approach and we go and tell them, oh, this is what our books tell us, and this is conservation by description, you know, given by the experts, this is how you should do. And we try and interject all these foreign thoughts and processes into the daily lives of our women, that they then become confused as to, you know, whether they should listen to the experts or what they've been doing for centuries. And so when they are at that situation, very often, because we go in there very authoritatively. I mean, like we, in the sense of either government or the outside agencies for change, they tend to listen to us, and then that's when disaster strikes. And so the most satisfying moment for me has been when these women have put down their foot and said, we know our local environment better than you. Thank you very much. This is how we'll do it.
So these capacities to develop the local adaptation practices, we need deeper understanding. So more research should be done in order to find out what is happening, what kind of resources, who are, how their resources are being bought at a very kind of low prices, adequate payment for environmental services. That should be one agenda. Second would be that in terms of women's rights to these resources need to be recognized. Women's, and when I say rights, I mean entitlement. Entitlement to land, entitlement to forest, entitlement to water bodies. Because they are the ones who are managing the resources. And it is not being against men, but if we don't develop their capabilities, if we don't give them title to land, there is a problem of incentive and there is a problem of productivity. They will not be putting as much effort as they would do if that they have the secure titles to these resources.
Women politicians and researchers have been inspired by the struggles of mountain women and can play a crucial role in trying to give them a stronger voice.
Women have taken the courage in their hands and are willing to fight. They must have enabling hands from people like you and me. So we give voice to those who are working, struggling. Therefore, there is a connect that you need to make there. And that is where feminists cannot be neutral. They have to have a view. And many of us who have a background of admiring Gandhiji feel that our entire life should be spent only to give that enabling hand to particularly to the poorest of the poor women. Once you focus on a particular class, you know, you're much more able to make an impact.
Women leaders, unfortunately, are still facing many obstacles, such as gender-based discrimination and exclusion from decision-making.
In India, they say, oh, she's a gender expert, so immediately you're marginalized. You're not seen as a thinker. You're not seen as somebody who can contribute to a discussion on some new corporate issue. You're only seen as somebody who, if they tap the head like a puppet, will go squawking about women. It's so humiliating, I can't tell you. So intellectuals, book launches on big public issues, we are not there. Summitry in Delhi, no, only a corporate woman or a film star comes to represent us. But a woman thinker, whom I've learned from women, but who can also think on other issues, is not there at all. So I've got ghettoized. And therefore, I advise younger generation, don't get ghettoized. Then I tell myself, never mind. You're a representative and a voice for some people that you care for. So relax, it doesn't matter.
Mountains need women leaders to protect the environment and adapt to climate change.
Thank you.